Again, thank everyone for attending, and boy, there's some beautiful carvings coming about. I'm just always blown away. Great, beautiful job. So today, a couple of announcements. If you have not registered at the Masonic Temple, please do so. It's very important that we have our numbers correct and that I'm able to keep going. And you got to register. You got to get your packet. You got to get your number so that when it comes time for, that's the most important thing, is that it takes you to the auction.
Why do you keep looking at me? Like?
I'm not looking at you. I didn't look at you yet, but I was going to.
This is Saturday.
Okay. Evelyn got her wallet back. Yay. Someone found it. Took it to St. Mary's. St. Mary's, the next town, took it, sent it back to Ridgeway, and everything is in it. That's quite nice. We have a pair of leather gloves and a square, if someone lost it, their credit card square.
Thank you.
Okay. And we also found the Stanley thermos, but it was returned. Somebody said it smelled like booze. Okay. Anyway.
No booze in it?
Was there booze? No. All right. Tonight, the dinner is at Alio's. I do believe it's a roast beef dinner, and there is a, I think it's $8.50. I'm pretty sure, $9, something. She said it was low. Groceries are expensive this year. But anyway, we have Tom Bob here today from the Outdoor Channel that's going to be filming our seminars. They've been filming along, right along, and coming to different things that we've been doing. And you're going to have a droid?
Drone.
A drone?
Yep.
A drone, whatever.
Yep.
See, I don't know what I'm talking about. A drone. And when's that coming in?
I'm not quite sure yet.
Okay,
I think. Work out what day?
I think either Thursday or Friday or something like that.
Yep.
So that's going to be,
yep.
It's going to be awesome.
Yep.
So we're pretty excited about all that.
We'll have to work it out, make sure we can fly it over town.
Yeah, well, I think it's okay.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm sure we'll be, but.
Yeah. So yeah, I'm going to mention it to our borough manager too. Okay. And now I'd like to introduce Scott Dow.
Weather.
Oh, the weather. Oh, wait, I have one more announcement. I'm sorry. This is, okay, as we look forward to the weather on the weekend, and I realize that we have, was it six people? Six people that need to get to the Bradford Airport on Sunday. And we could send, or Pittsburgh.
It's the same.
Pittsburgh Airport. And we've been checking the weather, and Saturday or Sunday does not look great for our van to go down and come back, because that area is going to be getting some snow. If anyone is driving in that area and can fit a carver or two, please let me know. Otherwise, our other option is to fly them from Bradford to DuBois or to Pittsburgh. Huh? Well, okay, but it is what it is. Anyway, just, yeah. So anyhow, now I'll introduce Scott. Scott comes to us from Cory, Pennsylvania, and there's, what can you say? He's an amazing carver.
Hey.
He's a nice guy, too.
How about the hair for Liz?
Do it again.
I came completely unprepared, because every time I come prepared, I realize that we're all on different levels, we're all from different parts of the globe, and we're not all prepared to hear the same information or drop to the same level. So I kind of thought that we would approach this seminar with you guys telling me what you want to know, or what you feel, some of you know the work that I do, what you feel I might be able to help you with, you know, what you guys lead the subject, and I'll do my best to fill in the blanks for you. I'm going to use the typical seminar format, where about 25% of the information I give you will be accurate, and 75% will be as believable as I can make it. You know, that's kind of the way I like to work. So I like to sketch a lot, because I'm not real good sometimes with spitting out in words what the information is that I think I know, you know, so sometimes I can put it on paper a little better, or on a chalkboard. So that's it. Where should we start? Is anybody, yes?
Can you talk a little bit about how you laminate pieces to form the wood so you can make the big pieces that you do?
You mean assembling parts?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
I can, I'm not the best at this. Somebody like Jeff Pinney's real good at this type of thing. Chris Foltz from Oregon is, I don't know if any of you guys are familiar with Chris Foltz, but he's like the master of taking a big log and exploding it into 150 pieces and putting it back together in some outrageous form. So I'm not necessarily the best guy to do it. I can talk about maybe the dinosaur that I did last year briefly and tell you guys how I approached that project. If I sit here, you guys aren't going to be able to see the board, but this is about the best I can do. The dinosaur was, I don't know if you guys saw it last year, but it was a 22-foot long T-Rex that I did. I had a small skid loader at my shop, so I was a little bit limited on what I could lift, so I had to kind of do it one piece at a time, so it was a bit of a challenge there. Basically, I had no plan in making a T-Rex until a log truck came and they dropped it in my parking lot, and one log just looked like a T-Rex head, and I said, yeah, that's what I'm going to try. So basically, the way I approached it was with the T-Rex, had a great big log that looked like a mouse here, and that's the one I saw in the log truck. And then I had another windy log that looked like a tail, and I just found two great big logs that I could fit together for legs. I carved those pieces best I could individually on the ground, because like I said, my loader wasn't big enough to lift them up. So laying on the ground, I carved the head of the T-Rex. and the neck and the body right on the ground, just rolling it back and forth, just mainly to get rid of weight, as much weight as I could, and give it a little bit of shape so I could start to tell where things were taking place. Same with the tail. The tail was laying down. A lot of times what I'll do is lay a log on the ground, and then the piece I'm carving I lay like this, and then roll this back and forth on the log. That puts this whole end at a really nice height to work. You know, I do that with big bears, 8-foot bears to 10-foot bears. I don't climb scaffolding anymore. You know, I'll lay them down and roll them along that log back and forth. And you kind of, if you stand at the feet of the bear, you get the same perspective as you do standing under a great big bear. So that's a real helpful hint if you don't have scaffolding, if you're tired of going down scaffolding. Carve like this. Anyway, so I did the tail like that. I did some work on the head like that, and the legs I carved individually. To start that, I went in on chalkboard like this and just got a general, very general sense of what I wanted that thing to look like. So now I had the legs blocked out, both legs, this blocked out and the tail blocked out. I went out and decided the height I wanted, and I cut just two logs that came to a point like that, and lifted one end of the skid loader. You know what? There might be a picture of him back a little bit deeper. It would have been August of 13.
There you go.
Yeah, there you go. So by having those points on logs, it gives you room to work all the way right to that point. The whole log's not in your way. So I lifted one end of the head up, got it on the log, and then the tail, and got it on the log. The tail actually inserts into the rear of the dinosaur a full 30 inches, and then I could pin it this way. When I say pin it, I did it originally without any screws, and then I ended up adding screws anyway, just because I thought transporting it, I started loading it on the trailer and transporting it around, I thought those pins were going to eventually start to work loose, so I use Timberlock screws in addition to that. But all of the weight, this thing would stand on its own without any fasteners at all. The tail was inserted 30 inches, and the legs, which was simply making a flat spot to match up to that body, had a ledge on it that I could rest the body down onto that ledge, and gradually, the back log that's sitting on the point lowered that down and dropped it till it sat on the legs. That way I wasn't putting, if you understand what I mean, all the weight now is on that back point of the rear end of the dinosaur. Yes, that point. So I lowered that until all the weight came to the legs. The reason I did that is because I didn't want to put screws or pins in it and then have all the weight on the screws and pins. I wanted it to actually be on the ledges of the So there's no glue and just a few timberlock screws.
Oops. Sorry.
Basically the way I did it. The legs I just made flat spot. And a flat spot, and then I'd wiggle it in there and get it in, and then realize my flat spots were all that flat, and I'd wiggle it back out and make them a little flatter until I got it to match as good as I can. Of course, I didn't. If you're really good at this and you really know what you're doing, and you have access to tons of different sizes of material and equipment, you might want to consider more with grain direction than I did. I mean, I just took the grain and made it the strongest way. You know, legs. Vertical grain direction, you know, the tail and the body were, but when you cross grain like that, they shrink different directions. So it's something you gotta have to be aware of and be able to be willing to live with the joints you have and realizing the nice thing about these legs is I could tighten it as it dried. I had it on my property for almost a year and I had access to all the bolt heads. So I tightened it a couple times in there, and it just pulls those joints back together because if you know, wood shrinks one way a lot, and endwise it doesn't shrink at all. So if you are joining stuff together a lot, it's definitely something you want to consider because your pieces will shrink different directions than the joints will.
What about your weight balance? I mean, that's really, I mean, there's a lot of weight there, and I mean, it's such a dynamic piece that...
I just guessed, to be honest. I actually ended up cutting 6 foot off of the tail from the original tail because I wanted to make sure it cantilevered the head. And the neck, obviously I made the head as hollow as I could get it, just to make it as light as I could get it because it was big, it was the biggest part and it was hanging way out front. And the neck is really probably 6 inches thick from the front view, but you can't see it because the shoulders and the head are in the way. So this is one, I'm not a huge power gouge using carver. I find in most cases the chainsaw is faster and easier for me. But in this case, the power gouge was indispensable because that piece is so big. You guys know the bigger the log is, the harder it is to get at certain things. You just don't have the reach, you know, unless you're using a humongous saw, and then you got a humongous saw you're trying to throw it. So like to work down the sides of that body with a power gouge, it was a perfect height, and the gouge you can kind of work from the end. So to hollow all that neck out and get all those textures into the gouge was a really great tool in that case. Did I answer your question at all, or did I ramble in totally different directions?
Where is T-Rex now?
Sold him to a private buyer in the Catskills.
Anywhere?
And up in the Catskills.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah, Paul.
Yeah, I wasn't going to head off in that direction. I mean, that's one of the most epic pieces. You Google chainsaw carving, hey, this dinosaur comes up. So that's got a lot of eyes. Can you just speak to what other kind of interest? I mean, you got a buyer, but anybody else from the West Coast give you some interest?
Not really. I do a lot of small dinosaurs, so it's led to a lot of business for me. I haven't had anybody ask for any full size. You know, dinosaurs from there, but that's not my own. Yeah, cages, T-Rex, you want to see a T-Rex. I don't know if you guys are familiar with Keiji from Japan, but he's clearly one of the top carvers in the world.
Where's he at?
He inspired me to do a T-Rex, actually.
Spell it?
Keiji, the picture was up there.
Yeah, I know.
Keiji Kibikoro.
Where?
Looks
more like Kaiji.
Is it Kaiji?
They look like that.
Yeah.
Get a coral. It's actually a K.
How do you spell dinosaur?
I don't know, but that mouth is great down there, too. Anyway, let's keep talking and maybe you find out. What else you guys?
the horse and rider, when you guys did that over in Germany. Like a big
all-thread.
Can you speak on that
whole thing? Yeah, and there's actually an image on my Facebook. It would have been May, June 2012, where we did that. There's some images of that piece going together too. And that, of course, was. Of course, everything leads back to Ridgeway. for me. It's one thing I want to say about the Rendezvous. I don't know how many guys are first time, and some of you guys have been here a long time. Yeah, that speech we did in Germany in 2012.
I'm going to brighten it up here.
But I met Bob King here at Ridgeway, and it's just that I've met so many people, have led me so many different directions and made connections all around the world. But that's really what makes Ridgeway such a special place, you know. It just grows, and you get to know more and more people, and the opportunities just seem to come. But anyway, Bob King invited me to be on his Husky Cup team, and the other carver was Chris Foltz, the ice carver out of Oregon. And we had 5 days, that's 16 feet to the tip of the sword, I think, 16 or 18 feet. It's carved out of red oak. And are you able to find the one that shows it in pieces? Or shows it still in blocks? In the meantime, I'll sketch out kind of how we did that. We showed up in Germany. We had never, Bob King and I carved together briefly here in Ridgeway, just to kind of get to know each other. And Chris, I had never met him, so we talked over the phone and over the internet a little bit and exchanged some ideas on what the horse that we wanted to do, exchanged some drawings that I would send him. And then Chris made templates.
Is it on your Facebook?
It's on my Facebook. It should be May 2012, I think.
If you would carve fewer pieces, it'd be easier to see.
I know.
Okay, here we go.
There's chunks.
Right there. So you can see we leaned three major pieces up. And I think the piece that has the king's face on it there in the backside, I think that was 11 feet at that point. And they were big. So we leaned them up. And spent a lot of time on the angles of that center joint and also the angles where it met the ground. Chris was in charge of that, Chris Foltz, and when he dropped that into place, I could not believe how it fit. It was like, it would have taken me, I would have pulled it apart and recut it and recut it and recut it. Just don't have the eye for that type of thing. If you ever start piecing stuff together, you'll realize how difficult it can be, you know, to make big planes meet perfectly like that. But anyway, that's basically how we started that project. The front left leg was added, the arm and the sword was added, the arm with the reins was added, and the horse's head was added. That was the end of, I think, the first day, or maybe halfway through the second day. But basically, we approached it. We got to Germany. Chris had brought big template drawings of the sketches that I had sent, and we laid it out on the floor. They were full size drawing. Laid it out on the floor. Calculated the size of material we had, which isn't as easy as it, you know. You guys probably know it's not as easy as it seems because the logs are round. So if you're looking at a log from the side and it's 24 inches wide, you think you have 24 inches of material, but you don't because it's round. So you got to kind of consider that. But we laid it out on the template, and you can still see the spray paint. The orange spray paint marks are from Chris's templates. We skinned the log, laid the templates on, and he spray painted the basic general idea on there, just like you guys, or just like a lot of you sketch on the log, same idea. And then we got rid of his, we weren't sure how to start, you know. We didn't, three guys, not sure exactly how to go. And Bob said, well, there's certain things we know aren't there. You know, certain parts of this thing that we know are gone, so let's get rid of those. That's kind of how we started. It took a little bit to get into the groove, but by the end of the 5 days, we were just spinning around it. It was just the greatest learning experience ever, you know, so. And you wanted to know about the rod going through. So basically, there was a 7 foot, I think, 2 7-foot rods through this that were at least an inch in diameter. They were big, big, heavy-duty rods. So we started, I don't remember, either the neck or the rear of the horse, and drilled with a 3-foot-plus drill. Drilled through until we got to the center, and then we went as deep as into the center log as we could. And then we moved the rear out of the way, and followed through that same hole. Actually, we probably did both holes at the same time. followed through that hole as deep as we could, moved the back, and then did the same thing. So you went the rest of the way through the center and then into the front piece. And you go as deep as you could so that when you move the piece and you start, it's going the right direction. So you get a straight line through there. And again, it was another thing I said, there's no way that we can put a 7-foot rod through this thing. And we did. So that's how we did it, though.
Anyway. Are you kind of concaving off the each so that you're not fighting all that surface area where it's more? I think Jeff had it out.
Did we hollow any of that out?
Right.
None. We did. I see what you mean. What Jeff's saying is if you're putting two pieces together, if you're joining two flat pieces and you want to join them like this on seam, and say these are two round logs, you want to put end to end just to be simple. He's saying, did you make it concave? Which makes total sense to do that. So if you concave the center, dish that center out, the edges will hit all the way around. And then if they don't match, all you have to do is cut around this edge to make it match. You're not recutting the whole thing every time. So it's a great way to join stuff up easily so you're not fighting, not perfectly flat spots. We didn't do that. We wanted all the meat to be right there, so we just made a really flat. Bob had a straight edge, and he worked it and spent hours on just those two flat spots, but they, when they matched, they were dead accurate, flat. So, yes?
How about the shrinking? When the log shrank, or how does it look now? Did it shrink?
We looked at it.
Come back and tighten it up?
Or? Yeah, they tightened it up there. The Husky Cup is a real unique place because all the competition carvings for years and years go onto the property, so he's really specific about what he wants. Some years he did columns for the architecture and things like that, but in this case, we had to allow access to the head, to the nuts,
so that they could just tighten those nuts.
Yeah, pull it back together. I mean, the nice thing about this, the grain is relatively the same. We didn't have,
cross grains
going completely different directions, or it would be more of an issue. But when we were there the following year, it looked. It just never moved. So
right on.
That was good. They spend a lot of time maintaining their.
Can you talk at all carving like female horn or like the face? That's a big thing. But I found that it's real subtle cuts. You're better off doing that because you don't get physical type features and stuff.
Right.
Are there little tips on trying to get a pretty female?
Well, I mean,
that's a good
question. I always kind of approach female, I think, of a couple different things. The jaw on a female tends to be less meat, less muscle here, less of a big chin, rarely a big heavy dimples, a softer brow. Smaller nose, just smaller, like you said, smaller, less chiseled features is really all there is. As far as making it pretty, I mean, that's a pretty, I think we all probably have a somewhat different sense of what makes,
looking at delicate features rather than strong,
masculine, delicate, yeah, exactly.
You have a beautiful woman that has strong features.
Yes.
But you're talking about having that smooth, delicate look kind of thing? Or
and that was something I really struggled with that on a recent Indian that I carved because I wanted a strong woman, but at the same time I wanted it to be a woman, not an answer. It was a little bit of a challenge. I wanted to give her a little bit more of a jaw, of a sense of strength, but at the same time make her feminine. That was a good challenge. But I think you answered your own question, Joe. I mean, you really soften everything. You don't have those chisel marks. Delicate nose, delicate brow. Those are old, all chainsaw. You're talking about that angle,
yeah,
that initial angle.
Yeah, just to like block it out and get it out of the game.
Yeah, what they're saying is, this is the top view. Let's say, for example, that this log is roughly the same size as a head. They're saying that if you give yourself an angle to start with, cut right off your log. Right, that's what you guys are saying.
Okay.
Then that's a great, from the top view, you know, cut right down. That's a great starting point for a face. You automatically put your nose out to the front. Is that piece still up there? And you can kind of see that angle. I mean, the top of her, the forehead is angled back. Eyes are obviously back behind the forehead, and the cheeks are all angled back. A lot of things that I see in people. A lot of carvings I've been looking at even this weekend with people going out on a limb and trying something they're not used to, like human forms that are really hard, is people tend to want to work from the front on a face. They want to look at the face and they want to try and carve it and carve it and carve it and carve it. And you really need to do it from the side. You really need to do it from all dimensions, you know. You need to, if you're, doesn't matter what you're carving, if you're carving, let's do a head just for, You really need to try to figure out what a basic form is of what you're carving, whether it's a bear or a human head, from the different angles, the side view. Just to give you your basic shapes. What's the head look like from the top view? But anyway, the more you can understand, if you're trying to carve a human head, you should look at it from the top. So, you know, what is that shape from looking down on it? What is the shape of the face looking straight at it? That's the one we all know because we're always looking at each other, you know. How far are the eyes apart? Another great trick or something to do, again, no matter what you're trying to carve, is referencing points back and forth. Where is the eye in relationship to the mouth? You know, what is that distance? Where is it in relationship side to side? Where is the eye in relationship to the forehead? Where is the eye in the forehead in relationship to the chin? Keep going back and forth and back and forth. And then from the side view, rotate it 20 degrees and make those same references over and over and over, because then you're working three-dimensionally. When you're trying to make a three-dimensional carving from one viewpoint, it can't be done. I mean, it's really hard. The only way you can do that is if you have beautiful lighting and you really understand the way to read the light and dig in that way. You have to work around and around the pieces to pull that off.
There's a guy named Neil Cox, I don't know if you know who he is. He's an amazing carver. When we were in Ontario, we had a very similar seminar with Neil. He's brilliant, you know, he really understands human form.
It's similar other than the brilliant part.
The brilliant part is always there for him. But yeah. It was me and Bob and a bunch of you know, Jordan and everyone. We were just all like looking at this guy, like, you know. And one of the things he discussed with the human form is just like you said, you know, you can look down, but also when you take a human head, and he did this, and everyone's like, you know, because we always want to go right at it.
Right.
Same with bears, same with any kind of bird, you know, you got to get that 360. But one of the big things was he just tilted his head back so you can see what the face looks like from underneath. And he said, a human head, I don't care how big around your face is your head, it's got that distinctive, you know, even if your cheeks are, you know, heavier.
Right.
But, you know, if you lean your head back and you ask the guy next to you to lean back, you can see.
The shape of the jaw, yeah, is that V. That,
yeah, it's, yep, distinctive. It's almost more so than if you look down, you know, because you get the full-on part of the jaw and everything. And,
yeah,
and it really made me look at it completely differently.
And that's really the key with all this stuff, I think, Jeff, too. You know, understanding the structure that doesn't change underneath. Everybody's skull is basically the same thing, whether you're a pretty girl or not pretty girl, like Danny. I mean, the skull is basically doesn't change. It's the flesh and the muscle on top that's where it starts to build more character. The skull's very, very similar. It's like carving any type of animal, a bear, for example. The understanding, number one, the major forms of it. You've got the skull, you've got the rib cage, and you have the pelvis. Those things don't really change all that much. And then from there, you have to understand the mechanics of the arms and the legs, or the legs. Understand the potential for them to move. Where does the shoulder move? You know, in a person, there's a lot of shoulders are really difficult, or at least they are for me. You have to understand, yeah, the way the arm meets that shoulder, and then what's the potential for the movement of that? I mean, a person can lift their arm like this, a person can lift their arm like this, that. You know, understanding that, and then being able to pull it all together in something that's somewhat natural of a position, but it all comes down to understanding that underlying structure and knowing the parts. The rib cage essentially does not change, you know? However you put it in space, whether he's a guy standing perfectly straight or somebody leaning off to the side, leaning forward, the rib cage stays the same. It doesn't change. A lot of times when you see people trying to move things through space, they start to morph. You know, that shape starts to stretch and become get out of place. If you can, in your mind, say, okay, here's where the skull is, here's where the rib cage is, and keep those forms there underneath without bending them, that helps a lot. And then the shoulders are where you start to see differences. The shoulders can go forward and back, and you know, and then it starts to take some homework. Okay, what else? Or did I not answer that? Yes.
I've only been carving 4 years, but I've had aha moments. I wondered what your aha moments are. I, for instance, started out trying to get as realistic as possible. Then I did piercing and deep cuts, and then I've just started working with distortions and flow of lines so that I can mash pieces together.
Mm-hmm.
So what are your aha moments?
Oh man, that's a good question. Well, my first aha moment in chainsaw carving, my first year, I thought that I had a little art background, you know, and I thought I could be the greatest thing that ever happened to chainsaw carving, you know, that kind of attitude, the kind of that I don't have anymore, but I had at the time, you know. So, man, I'm going after this, so I started going into competitions, and that's where I first met Jerry, I first met Ben Risney, and I first met a guy by the name of Hayashi Takao. So this is my first competition. I showed up with my two or three dull chainsaws, you know, and my attitude and
wrong bars.
Yeah, wrong bars, street wrong cutting equipment. Bars, and.
But you sure came out of that one with a bang. Because after you did and went, you got retooled.
After I learned. But that was an aha moment. I carved some goofy bird or something. The Schnecksville competition was put on by Brian and Jen Ruth, masters of the chainsaw, and it, to this day, I think is the best run competition I've been at. I mean, it's really straightforward. This is what we're going to do. Here's how we're going to judge it. everybody's got the same size log. Everybody's on the same playing field. You're going to do a bird this hour. You're going to do a fish this, or a aquatic this hour. You're going to do a mammal this hour. And you got 4 hours. You're going to do a, an open thing.
Where is this?
It's in Schnecksville, Pennsylvania.
It's the Masters of the Chainsaw. I've been there. The third longest running event of our careers.
And they just bring in
17 years.
They bring in these carvers. So anyway, my aha moment. So I carved this stupid looking bird, you know, that I was pretty proud of it. You know, there's sawdust flying. I'm, you know, didn't know what I was doing.
Chainsaw only.
Chainsaw only. And I turn around and I ask, she has two flamingos crisscrossing each other with four legs that had to be half inch diameter with little knees and little feet. And I'm like, whoa, you know. But I was young. I still had that attitude. So I'm like, all right, he got this one, you know. not even to mention what Ben Risney, I don't remember what he did, but I'm sure it was as wonderful as well. These guys are in an hour. It's amazing. And so the next one was a fish thing, and I did this, you know, poorly done swordfish. But, you know, at the time it seemed like I got this, you know. And I'm working too hard to look up and see what Ayashi's doing. And so I carve this stupid looking fish, and I go over, and Ayashi has this two frogs laying on lily pads that are like this high at a log, and their legs are hanging down, little spindly legs. And like, so I was like, aha, these guys are just way, I shouldn't even been there, you know. It's that type of aha moment. I have to mention, I asked you one more competition, the one in Minnesota.
But you went from stumbling around there to the U.S. Open and kicked everybody's butt.
Yeah.
Won a $5,000 purse.
Yeah, that was a good show there.
So all development, all in a year.
Yeah, I mean, that's like back to coming to the Rendezvous and doing these different events. You can pick away at things in your own shop, and I did that the first almost a whole year. I didn't look at anything. I didn't go to any events. I didn't come here. I just wanted to develop my own style. But I realized at the end that, man, you waste a lot of time. You could get information from other people and learn so quickly. So one more of Hayashi's carvings. This was later in Minnesota, but I still am just so impressed with this guy. But so I tried a horse in a one-hour speed carving. It was a big log, and I was tired. It was the end of the event. You know, the logs were 24 inches around, 5 feet tall, and it was 1 hour. You know, my equipment's dull, and I just want to go home. And so I tried this horse, and Hayashi carves a monkey riding an ostrich in 1 hour. It's just beautiful. So a little humble pie is good for all of us.
He stopped betting Hayashi after that.
Yeah.
I got all these pictures of somewhere.
Yeah, that's hero over there, isn't it?
Yep.
Oh, you're in.
That's U.S. Open.
No, that's the wrong year, though.
Yeah. There's Hayashi's right there.
Yeah, that's one of Hayashi's 4 hour pieces of the elephant with a.
No, that's.
Out of the 8 hour or a full.
That's a 16 hour. 16 there, hour one. U.S. Open.
With him, you couldn't tell. I mean, he's the kind of carver that. You know how when you carve down the grain on one side, your saw's running a certain way, it doesn't leave fur. But when you got to go to the other side, your saw's opposite, it leaves all those furs. Right. He doesn't leave any fur. He carves with his saw upside down somehow. fluidly that it's just, to watch him go around those
In
things.
Japan, they mostly stick chainsaw only.
Yeah,
so.
So anyways, terrific learning experience. And all of it comes from here. I mean, I ended up in Schnecksville because of the Ridgeway. And met Brian and Jen Ruth and Hayashi and Bob King and everybody. So where are we going now?
Oh, wow.
When you have to travel like overseas, how do you get all your gear there? Or how do you make sure you got all the stuff you need when you're there?
If you're Bob King, you get there and there's a big giant box full of all your stuff, perfectly packed. If you're me,
borrow from Bob King.
I try to get on Bob's team. I borrow stuff. I pack my little. Until last year, I never used any but chainsaws myself, so it wasn't much of a. I would take a few of my carving bars and borrow saws. I mean, that's typically the people inviting international carvers are going to be prepared. So you have the equipment. So if you have specialized carving bars that you really like, or certain ways of, you know, certain chains that you like, then you want to take that kind of stuff. But otherwise, any events I've gone to, they set you up pretty good. So does that answer that? Who else?
What's your favorite piece that you've done? I know it always changes, but sometimes like.
Usually it's my last piece I tried to. Just because I'm always. I've learned over the years that I just try to let it go. I used to try to hang on to stuff, you know, I don't want to sell that one. I love that piece. And then 6 months later, you're like, oh my God, I hope I sell this piece of crap, you know. But usually it's what I'm excited about at the time, so which is typically the last piece or two that I've worked on. The hillbillies right now are the most fun I'm having. I had a lot of fun with some skulls this winter. It was cold and I was working on some real hollow forms. So I would say that group right there right now is the ones I'm most excited about.
How'd you get on that kick?
Well, I knew I was coming to Ridgeway and I wanted to fit in a little better.
I read your Facebook last night. That's why I asked the question. You can pay me later. it's written right up there.
I was looking at your hillbilly pieces, in fact, the other day, and how do you decide whether to, like, the dress has these bar marks on them?
Mm-hmm. The lines.
Yeah, the lines that make it, you know, the pattern, the color pattern or whatever of the dress. How do you choose to, you know, do or not do those types of things in a texturing sense for a carving?
Well, because I want to change it from the skin. So if you have skin and you have a thinly layered dress, you got to do something. So because just the line at the top and the bottom aren't necessarily separated.
Right.
So it's just, when you're working in sculpture without color, which is what I prefer to do, not that I don't love color, and I'm sure it's, you know, but you're working with light, in other words. So every line you, every mark you make in your chainsaw creates a shadow or a highlight or both. So the deeper that line, the deeper that cut is, the deeper the shadow. So the stripes, just trying to create, they create dark stripes.
Yeah. I think it accentuates the folds. As well, because you can bend them and
direction it.
Direction.
You can make that look like it's hanging off your shoulder.
Yeah, it all just goes straight across. They actually kind of curve around it.
Right.
Yeah, and it really helps with your.
It helps to hide stuff that you didn't quite work out.
That's where all that came from.
Overcuts.
Lots of overcuts.
It's empty.
But textures create surfaces that, how do I say it? You can make something appear soft versus hard depending on the texture, you know. It's just like if you have a perfectly smooth flat surface, it reflects light very differently than a surface that's very rough, you know. So it is just playing with those. I work under good lighting all the time for that reason. You know, you can't work under, sometimes it's hard out here to carve because when there's no sunlight and the light is really flat with the snow, it's really kind of hard to see that kind of form changes by using light. That's all there.
Do you do you sketch it out first, or how do you work it out?
Very little. Like in the hillbilly drinking the jug is, or the girl with the shotgun, I sketch both those out, but very general. With the guy drinking, you know, I have to do it to visualize it, so I got a jug of whiskey. No, I didn't. But, you know, I just did that in my shop in front of my chalkboard and kind of felt the back movement. So that was my, you know, I basically figured, all right, that's the gist of his back. And then knowing I wanted the guy to be somewhat balanced, or a little bit off balance, but not too far off balance, the base of the skull I try to line up with, or typically roughly with the heels, you know, so that line is there. So I figured that out. And then I worried about the two arms, you know, if this is where his head is and his shoulders, you know, just like that, what does that arm do? Because that, you know, that jug. And if that arm does that, what does the other arm do? You know, something like that. And that's all I drew it. And so basically I'm trying on one side of the carving that doesn't have this arm, I'm just finding that arc. Because you got to know that, at least that much information to get started, and then you kind of free form it from there.
Basically, you use a stick.
Yeah. I'd love to build off stick men. I mean, if you were at my other seminars and we were talking about moving or whatever, it doesn't matter if it's an animal or a person. I love to draw off I don't call them stick men, but I like to build on that line, you know. I like to use that same line. If you're working on a side view, and that's your dynamic line, you know, your feet are there and your head's there, we'll say. Again, those parts that don't move, where are they in here? Find that rib cage there, and the hips there, and the legs here, we'll say. So I like to build them. If you're talking about a bear turning in a log, it's the same thing. You know, you got your head there, rib cage there, hips there, and I just try to, using that bending line, find those forms that don't move on there, and then fasten the legs to them, you know, and figure out those. But again, it comes down to understanding the basic shape of those forms and then the mechanics of the movement. You know, how does that leg work? Where is it? Where is it? Moves here, and it moves here, and it moves here.
Can you talk a little bit about modeling in clay? I know you do that sometimes.
Mm-hmm. Clay is, Jeff, do you model stuff?
Sometimes, yeah.
Clay is an awesome material, especially to work out ideas in small scale. You know, clay's decent big scale too, but you have to build armatures and things to support the clay itself, metal armatures and frames. But the nice thing about clay is it's, you can add and subtract. So, you know, it's not like us wood carvers that once it's gone and you got to come up with plan B. You can add back on. So, I like oil-based clay for really small stuff. Sitting at home in front of the TV, can work out little animal forms or heads or whatever project you're into. You can, you know, if you have a problem that you can't quite figure out how the wing works or whatever the problem is, you can work that out in oil-based clay at home. Never dries, you can use it over and over and over again. For bigger stuff, head-sized stuff, water-based clay is really nice. It's not a permanent material, really, unless you're into ceramics and you're able to fire it, and then you have a whole other set of problems keeping things hollow so that they don't blow up in firing. But I would recommend at least oil-based clay to everybody.
That's
to
get great stuff.
Get a little block and try. Yeah. If you're going to carve a duck tomorrow, sit at home and with your iPad and make a little tiny oil-based duck, and it really helps. You know, like always go back to understanding those very basic forms, you know. Understanding if you're making an owl, you know, what is that very basic? Don't worry about where the eyes and the beak and the claws, and you know, what is the basic, the most basic shape, and get that out of the wood, and then pull that detail. But, yes.
Are you starting to use some of the modern tools like the bamboo and the Sculpties, computer pro? Yeah, Bamboo Create is a pad that you can draw on. And
yeah,
it goes right into a computer. It's use a computer program like Sci or Paint or any of the
others. I'm not. I know they're wonderful programs. We used a program called Rhino a little bit. I was just getting into it, introductory level. But no, I'm going backwards. I'm rebelling against technology. I installed a new chalkboard in my shop. I did. I have giant chalkboards everywhere. I love drawing in chalk. And
it's a little easier when you have kids to teach you how to do the new
technology. It is. It is. But yeah, I would, anybody that has, I know Richard Hamilton's into those types of programs. So I would definitely recommend it if you have the, you know, it's just any way to work out ideas. Is a good way. I do a lot of sketching at home. Sit around with a sketchbook and an iPad and just work out.
When you went up to the Hackensack event, what's your process of what you're going to design, what you're going to compete with? Do you go through, tell us a little bit how you come up with a new piece that you're going to challenge other people with?
Well, That was a few years ago, and I did a little bit different back then.
How do you nowadays?
If it's a serious piece, I'll make it out of plasticine, out of oil-based clay. An idea, but you don't have the log, so at Hackensack that year that Jerry's talking about, I made a Viking, I think, turning.
Viking with a stream and water.
This is one of my first year carving or so. But yeah, so I worked that Viking out anatomically as good as I could.
On paper, in
oil-based clay.
In the clay.
And then sometimes I'll go from the clay to sketchbook. So actually sketching from the clay, because I can't always, you know, if I can't figure something out in the clay or... So make a scaled model. Basically, if you figure you're going to get... I think in that case they told us we were going to get 1 8-foot log that was 24 or 28 inches diameter or something like that. 28
to 30.
Right. So I made that in scale, basically. I rolled a piece of clear, it was from a folder, just a clear laminate piece of plastic and rolled it. So I had the right proportions that I could keep putting over my model. So I knew it was going to fit into a 28 inch diameter log.
Is that the Viking that is just up there?
Did I pass it?
Yeah.
Yes.
There it is.
That other one's a better.
It was cool.
Well, there's a cool guy in the back there. Look at that guy.
Well, that's something you'd expect.
Yeah. It was fun. It was a tremendous
Now, you chose Viking because of the area?
Because it was Minnesota.
And that's very popular in that area.
Yeah.
So that went into your process for
yep.
to yeah, help?
Definitely.
Because you get 50% of your sales as well.
Right.
Yep. Okay.
I mean, sometimes I think we're all in this game for different reasons, you know, and I was definitely in it for different reasons back then than I am now. Now, to me, it's more of a personal challenge, especially at an event.
Some of these guys are thinking about competing, so this right. talk right now is getting them lined up, what they can do for homework, what right. they can get prepared.
And competitions are terrific, just for nothing else is to be around the guys that you're, you know, to get thrown together and get this giant thing of material in these time limits and push each other to do better. If anything else, you will get better at what you're doing. But I was always guilty of over-preparation. I didn't, you know, especially when I first started competing, I really thought I knew what I was doing. Probably my weakest part was the actual chainsaw carving part in the beginning, for sure it was. I didn't know what I was doing much with a chainsaw, but I had really done my homework on my anatomy and on my figure, and I knew what I was going to do, and and I've always approached competitions that way.
Hey, Scott?
Yes?
What are your thoughts about painting?
I'm not a wonderful colorist. I've just never taken the time to be really good at color. I personally don't paint my stuff. In most cases, I don't like painting something that cracks afterwards and then it doesn't look correct to me. The only things I paint are stuff that have been around and I'm bored with them and they don't sell and they're already cracked and split, so I can make it look like it was, you know, I can either repair it and do it one way, or I can, you know, finishing through the cracks and things that makes it seem like it's supposed to be there. Cracking is something that you got to learn to live with, and or you have to be prepared to dry the things out and repair them. I don't know how you approach this. I've always wondered that, but it's an issue.
If I can, if I'm like doing a really substantial thing, and if I can keep it for a long period of time, which most of the time any substantial thing will end up sticking around for an uncomfortable amount of time.
Right.
You know, so it will open up, and then I'm glad it does, and I welcome it, because before you get the inkling to show it to like a prospective customer, you can really, I don't putty much, I shim.
Yeah, me too.
I shim. And once you learn how to fix those kind of things, it's like nothing fazes you, man.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, I got an overcut. What overcut? I just fixed it, can't even see where it was. You
right.
know, it's like you get the grain going the right way, you match the colors, and then because of the way I color wood, I don't necessarily paint a lot. I do like to paint. I like color, but I go to the wood tones, and once you hit the wood tones over those fixed areas, they just absolutely disappear. Yeah.
First, it's a comment. Of all the carvers, I mean, there's wonderful carvers, but when I get to the rendezvous, in my mind, I say, what's Scott into this year?
Oh, yeah?
You know, and I recognize your work by the quality, not necessarily the subject. I mean, 3 years ago, and I want to ask a question coming to you, you were doing those open carving where you were stabbing in with that, you know,
right.
the invisible man, and you did a little bit with your porcupine this year, and that, and the owl there shows a little bit of that. You know, and then the next year we come in into the T-Rex, you know, and now the hillbillies, you know. But so there is something, some car, I mean, yes, you're at a level where probably whatever you make would put bread on the table for you. You know, and there are some, you know, it's just the soul of the artist is an interesting thing. And
right.
some people, I'm sure, as carvers who are concerned about the bread on the table, approach it like, what is selling now, and I'm going to crank those out. And I don't think you go that direction usually. You go with something inside that...
Yeah, but I do more than you see. You know, I don't post... The things I post on Facebook are the things that I personally am interested in and I care about. But there's a lot of owls and bears and eagles that I don't... You know, I'm hammering... I got to make money, too.
Sure.
And there's certain things that I feel like I'm getting better and better at. Human faces, Indians will sell, hillbillies I think will sell, you see. But at the same time, I'm not afraid to spend Monday morning making. I like to work in threes. I work in threes because in almost everything I do, because it helps me remember. I don't work in three of the same thing, but if I do three, if I'm going to do a bear, I do three bears, three different bears. I'll block them out together, then I'll go to the next stage together, and then I'll finish them together. And I do it just for, personally, it helps me remember things that, you know, things about them. It helps me remember anatomy and shapes, things that I blocked out originally. You know, what is the shape I use for the head when the ears are back, the ears are up. So anyway, but I do my share of money first. And I'm a 9-to-5-er, I work, I go in and I fire up my saws right off the bat and I work all day long and I go home and I try to forget about it. But I like to go in Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, make money. And at least what I perceive is going, I don't sell every, especially this time of year, I don't have sales every day. But I mean, you know, summer's coming and those bears are gonna sell, the eagles are gonna sell. And So I get past in the first couple days of the week what I think I need, my whatever your budget is, whatever your overhead is. I need, just for an easy number, $500 I need to make by Wednesday. And then from there, then you start to get into things that you're really personally interested in, you know. And then, because I can't relax. If I feel I haven't made money for a week, then I'm not good at anything, you know. I'm racing. I don't want to be racing through this thing. I want to, and, you know, my life's changed a little bit recently, so I don't race nearly like I used to be, like I used to. You know, I used to, you know, $400 a day was my number that I was going to carve that before I did anything else, you know. And I don't work quite that hard anymore. It just seems to come, you know. And I think I'm not so tough on myself, and my work has gotten better because of it. You know, I used to beat myself up if something wasn't up to par, and now I just accept that you know, I'm learning and getting better. I mean, there's, Jeff came down and looked at one of my hillbillies, and there's this one arm on the one that I know was wrong, and I know I screwed it up. I knew I screwed up right off the bat. I just couldn't figure it out. And I watched him. He walked up and looked at it and just dialed right.
Did not.
Yeah, you did. I just saw him like, oh, damn it.
What a bitch.
He saw it. He has the eye. But yeah, I mean, I don't want to make crap all the time anymore. You know, I want to be... When I'm gone, I want to have stuff that my grandkids would be proud if they saw. Hey, my dad did that, or my grandpa did that years ago. So I have changed that a little bit, but I do worry about making money at the same time. And I do plenty of those. So. I forgot to bring my super bit in. I was going to bring that one tool that led me to this project.
Is that an ice tool?
Ice carving for die grinder. It's a 4-inch long, super aggressive, about an inch and an eighth round. Elegant Ice Equipment carries them if you're trying to find it.
Yeah.
And it is, for me, it is the next step after a chainsaw. Like I said, for the first five years, I chainsaw exclusively. But then there were just things that I couldn't quite get to where I wanted to, eyes and some, you know, certain things that... I'm not like the Japanese, where they seem to get these amazing things with chainsaw only, and I still can't see how they do it. But the Super Burr does everything that a chainsaw doesn't like to do. All those weird, you know, on the sides of a beak into the face, or under the chin, under a beak, you know, putting the hook on a beak just so quick and so fast, and it never clogs up. And so other than it being a very dangerous tool, I think. So I don't endorse it that way. You're on your own if you buy one, but it is a fantastic, fantastic tool.
And you got to buy the extension and the special.
Yeah, you got to buy a special die grinder with the shaft replaced.
Has it some a different collar or something?
Yeah, it's a half inch. The tools don't have a shaft on them. The shaft screws into the tool itself. Yeah, that's not the bit I have, but that's the shaper. It's almost the same thing. That's
is that the one?
No. Right. No, that's not. It's the paddle style. There it is. But that, and that's actual size. Well, not on the projector. It's a full 4 inches long, and it's probably an inch and a quarter diameter at the base. And the teeth, it's aggressive enough that white pine doesn't clog it. You know how it clogs the green die grinders instantly, just about, if it's wet. It never clogs, and it really is the next step from a chainsaw. It's so fast.
In that video with Bob and Chris Fultz, it was the funniest thing I had ever seen, probably on YouTube ever in my life, is on carver.
Oh, the ice carving?
He was using one of those. Wasn't Chris using one of those bits? And he was absolutely destroying Bob with
ice.
And Bob was legitimately carving this beautiful piece.
Eagle, yeah.
And then Chris was over there just blasted at every single angle, and just Bob was wearing a hat. He's like, you know, he actually completed a beautiful piece, and Chris just completely whittled his ice block down to nothing with that bit. Like, with there,
a, yep. I carved pumpkins with that bit at a. My friends had a big party, and there were a bunch of cool people. I carved pumpkins with that super burr, and it was
is this
just
it?
I think that's.
Do you have that super burr with you, Scott?
I do, but I forgot to bring it here. So you, I'll come show it to you if you come down. Yeah.
That is a burr.
That's not it.
That's not it.
But that thing is. It really removes material. It's not. You know, there's no fumes. You can use it indoors.
Where was it? Give me some more keywords.
Elegant ice equipment.
Oh,
he's trying to find that video.
Yeah, the video. Give me some more. Where was it? What was the venue?
Somebody put it on. I think my wife put it on Facebook. Yeah, I saw it too. Mm-hmm. It is so funny. Mm-hmm. Oh my gosh. But you got to know the two guys, and if you do, it's even funnier. Cause
yeah. I did that to John Williams.
Who's not Chris Fultz's Facebook?
John's not in here.
Because it starts off and it's like, you know, Bob's doing his thing. It looks like Chris is going to start doing his thing, and then he nails him a little bit. You know, Bob's like, or whatever. Because inevitably, when you carve next to somebody, you're going to get
pelted with
a little something, something.
I did that to John Williams in the Big Buzz in Vermont. I went up and was carving. We did a one-hour speed competition. I was carving right beside John's. And I had a brand new power gouge. I don't know if you guys have power gouges, but they are, you gotta wear body armor if they're sharp. I mean, they throw quarter inch sized pieces of wood, and they'll throw them 20 feet and fill this room. Anyway, poor John's carving next to me, and I realized that a certain direction I could literally steer a rooster tail of quarter inch wood chips. John puts his back. So then, instead of working around my carving, I'm turning my carving. So that every cut, I was just covering him with, oh, it's so funny. So anyway. Yes?
Years ago, I talked to Jeff when we were still down at the motion control parking lot. I mentioned to him one time, why hasn't anybody in the carving industry here ever impregnated their product with oil or even hay, polyethylene glycol? I can impregnate them, keep them sweating.
I don't know. I do a lot of carvings. That would take a lot of material. And I think people do.
Big chamber.
That?
Go ahead. I decided that splitting was part of it.
Yeah.
You know, if you're carving out of a whole round log, it's part of the process. I've also decided that I'm not trying to. Jerry and I have a great history of talking about how what should be done with the base of a carving. Carved into rocks or plants or whatever, and I've always said, you know what, I don't want to hide the fact that this came out of this wall.
But that's a judging discussion.
Yeah, a judging discussion, not a personal discussion. But I mean, I love the fact that we're taking trees and making stuff out of them. So.
Yeah, and if you really want to avoid that, instead of going through all the chemicals and all that, just laminate, just get some kiln-dried stuff and go that way.
Right.
So that's what puts a lot of.
If that's your pre-work.
It's a lot of pre-work, but it's the end game.
Yeah.
Is extremely.
I know some people that are doing vacuum tank work, and it is leaking for a year and a half thereafter. They bring all that stuff in there, and then you always got this constant drain, so they cannot put it inside. They got to watch where they put it, and so you've just really filled it with a chemical that can dry and cake on your floors and everything else.
Right.
It's tough, but.
Yeah.
Well, if the guy really is concerned, you know, you don't really need to do like these big elaborate laminations. Just take like 4 6x6s and just glue them together or that are kiln dried.
Mm-hmm.
Just carve it like a log, like you would.
Right. Yeah. I think it comes down, and all our whole discussion comes down to what is the end product that you're after. I mean, if you're just happy to carve something that resembles a bear, then you don't have to do all that much homework. You don't have to worry about. But if you really, really want to nail a realistic bear, then you got to do the homework to do it. And I think, you know, you just kind of got to decide that when you get into the game. What am I after? How good does it have to be? Am I happy making a few dollars? Or you can do that kind of both ways. You approach the things you sell to make money, you approach one way, and then you have your personal things that you obviously put more homework in and more time into and more of your heart into, and try to find the balance in all that. And that's really where it's at. Being happy with what we do is the most important thing. So. Cool.
Are you going to carve John to California?
Well, you didn't see it? I started yesterday.
Oh, you did?
Yes, absolutely. What a character, huh?
Yeah.
Right here? Yeah, there he is. I thought that was my carving back there.
Yeah. Good practice with real smooth and real rugged on the same piece.
Scott, yeah.
Bring him up here a minute.
John, come on up here for a second. I'm into my, you know, my hillbillies. Not that he's a hillbilly, but stretch my imagination. But I'm real interested in people's personalities, and I think I just saw John, met John for the first time, and he's a happy guy and a fun guy to be around. I thought, man, what a great personality for a chainsaw carver. So.
What's your name?
John Mahoney. California.
He's a TV star, too.
Oh, come on.
Yeah. Yeah. The bar last night. And it was on the TV. Yeah.
Working down there with Steve Backus.
Yeah. Nice.
Oh, yeah.
But
he was at that Bailey's thing a few times.
Okay. Well, anything else that I can ramble on about? Or
the first time I met you, this is not about anything but your choices of your pieces and when you're going to, you know, when it's time to make your statement and when you just want to kind of turn a buck or, you know, make whatever. And the first time I met him was at Butler a couple of years ago, and everyone was kind of conforming. And this is what really set you apart, you know, because I'd seen your work and I loved it. But then when we were at Butler, you were doing those
gargoyles.
I was like, wow. How does... I was like, this guy is he's just feeding his soul, man. He's just like, and I was like, why can't I just do that? You know? My wife, she's like,
you better bring back some money.
Yeah, well, that's, and I probably didn't bring back, I probably want the least amount of money of
anybody. You were the happiest there. Guy probably there because of that.
I didn't care. I mean, it goes back to what we were just talking about making money at home. I make money at home every day, so when I get to be around you guys and go to events like that, of course, you do have options to think about that. I'm sometimes a little selfish, and I should be thinking more about making money for the event.
Yeah.
I mean, they still sold, so I almost paid my way, but...
Well, we live here in Pennsylvania, right? Yes. And in Butler's, how far from you?
Hour and a half.
So you almost paid your way. That's pretty good.
Right. Thanks, John.
Stop for lunch.
Right. So, you know.
One cup of gasoline.
Yeah. I think it was Stoner. Is he here? He said to me something about why I made gargoyles. I said, it's not about the money. He's like,
what?
It's not? Is it about the money? It's not always about the money.
It'll come.
But that's my last, go back up there, my last Huskies gut piece.
Which one? This one?
Not that one, but it was, yeah, go down, right there.
Yeah, that was
the order. That was this Germany, 13. But it was a unique competition.
Zodiac signs.
Zodiac signs, and they wanted them erotic.
Yes.
Females.
Oh, no.
That was a challenge, for sure.
That was tasteful. I thought that one really... When I looked at that thing, I was like, you gotta be kidding me. And who took that Did Denny get a...
Denny got second.
That was, Denny's piece was amazing.
Dayton and, took first.
Dayton won.
Who won? Dayton?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's just excellent.
That's a unique competition. If anybody ever has a chance to get there, I mean, it's...
Or just visit.
100,000 people through the gates during the week, and it's like a giant... They open the gates, it's like a giant caterpillar of people coming down off the mountain.
It's a Disneyland of our art.
Yeah.
The building's the longest table in the world.
Wow.
And he's taken all the competition pieces and used them in the architecture.
I saw that walkthrough video on YouTube of that. That was insanely cool.
Yeah, after whatever, I don't know how many he's done, 15 years now or 13 years.
13, I guess. But Andreas Martin. Yes, that. Andreas Malden. Martin.
So they built, you know, it's like a museum, so it's really unique.
That's cool that you could be part of that.
Yeah. Again, all leads back to Ridgeway. Where I met Bob. Okay.
Were you using this area to treat your carbons before you chip them out?
It depends on the destination a little bit. I personally prefer to use water-based stuff for personal health reasons. I think on the oil-based side, I use exterior deck stains. Sherwin-Williams makes a great one. Sickens makes a good one. I like the Sherwin-Williams a little better because it doesn't turn... Sickens, if it's real damp outside or if it rains on it all day, it kind of gets milky, and then as it dries back out and the color comes back. Where the Sherwin-Williams doesn't seem to do that.
After it dries initially, it'll do that?
The sickens? Seems to.
Really?
Once it's dry, if you leave it out in the rain, it rains 3 days, the carvings turn milky.
Because I know sometimes if you over-apply, it'll do that.
Well, maybe that's what I'm doing. That's very possible.
I find that,
yeah, I think it's
based on what you're working with, whether it's wet or dry, or some of my stuff is freezing the skin 3 weeks before, and cut in half, and it up and look. I find up in New Hampshire that Thompson's water seal works real well.
Mm-hmm.
End user can buy it, you know, at Home Depot or Lowe's.
Right.
And reason why, it, you know, as it dries based on the conditions, the sun and the humidity and whatnot.
Yeah, I have a customer that uses that. Sherwin-Williams makes a great product also. It's also an exterior deck stain, but it's water-based.
They're all water-based.
They have oil and water. You can still get either one. I prefer the water, just again for just using nasty stuff. It seems to. You can't put it on. You asked that, so I'm looking at you. It seems to. You can't put it on too early, because if your carving's soaking wet from just carving, I like to get 3 or 4 days of drying, just till it starts to want to see a little bit of cracking, and then I thin it down on the first layer and try to get it to. To soak in a bit. But this seems to be the case with any finish. If you get too much of a shell built up, then that's when you have a problem with peeling or anything else. But I think a good finish on wood, I've come to realize, takes place over time. There isn't one finish that's the answer to everything, at least on wetter unseasoned wood. So
and the Thompsons, I used some of that just recently, a couple months ago when it was halfway decent outside. I was looking for some sickens and I couldn't find it. I'm like, man, I got to do something. I got to get something on these before, because we were supposed to get some rain and they were nice and dry. And I'm like, man, I got to move on this.
Yeah, right now's the time.
So I was looking for a wood tone and I found Thompson's. I never did like Thompson's. I used it in the past, and it was just it's like sometimes it would work, other
things. Right.
But I bought this stuff, and it's like it's got different wood tones to it. I don't know if anybody's ever seen it or heard of it, but I bought it at Home Depot or something.
It's got different tints in the Thompson's.
Yeah, and it does a pretty nice job. The only issue is with the oils, you can layer and get different, you can mix like a walnut transparent.
Right.
You can get different depths and different depths of transparency, and so that one color can actually span a bunch of different. Well, when you put that watercolor stuff on, it dries, and then you can't do anything very over top. Yeah. You can't do anything over top because it repels any moisture.
Right, right, yep.
So whatever you do, it has to be a solid color, but it seems to be working beautifully.
One thing about the Thompson, though, it's got paraffin in it, which is a wax base.
Yep.
So once it's on, you can't come back with your other colors.
Right.
Or anything else, because it'll bead or fall right off.
That's right.
So it's got to be just plain wood.
I think thinned down linseed oil is a good base for almost any finish, it seems. Just, you know, if you, right when your carving's done, if you want to get something on it, but you're not necessarily ready to completely finish it, a real thin linseed oil and mineral spirits, and then you don't have to do anything for a long time. And you can still go to a water base even after that, can't you?
You can do anything after that.
Because it just disappears, basically.
Or else you can go to a sanding sealer.
Not that technical, or it's not that nasty. You know, linseed oil doesn't stink, and it's not
and if you that
toxic. Linseed oil is far.
Yeah.
Or if you got a punky.
Linseed oil helps the inside fibers stay moist. Like it helps it, you know, but it does, your carving will still turn black. So if you put spar on,
solves the black problem.
You know, it still allows it to, like, dry out. But if you do both, it's a two bits.
I think spar has a UV.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But commercial spar is good. Yep. Big bit, just a slight bit.
The linseed oil molds too, that's why.
Unless you put that M1 in it.
Oh,
you
yeah.
Buy a little package. But if you got a punky log, you can use sanding sealer. Cut it 50%. That'll harden that right up.
Time? It's time. We're done. Woo. Anybody wants to? Thank you. If anybody wants to see that Super Burr tool, I'm down by the Country Squirrel in the corner. I'd be happy to show it to you. It's awesome.